More and more people find themselves drinking at the wells of each other's spiritual traditions and engaging in a deep and common quest. The responsive chalice lighting words are in your order of service. When strangers meet, endless possibilities emerge. When strangers meet, each pays special attention to the other. Today, this morning, let's light the chalice for openness,
for willingness to grow,
for rich curiosity,
and for common purpose.
Good morning.
Good morning.
And thank you for welcoming me. I particularly appreciate Gail's inviting me to be here, and I appreciate her delivering the message at my church. I was able to meet with her this morning and left her over there as I came over here, and so it's all good. It's good. She asked me to talk about my church, and so I'm going to start with the obvious. And then I'm going to go back to the beginning, and then eventually I'll get there. I am a Christian. I am an ordained Christian pastor. Specifically, I am a Protestant Christian, and more specifically, I am a Methodist Christian. And those things all do go together, more or less, sometimes better than others. But as such, I am pretty new on the scene of belief systems, religions, faith traditions, because we have belief systems and faith traditions that go all the way back into prehistory, right? We have some of those around here with our Native Americans. We have very, very old religious traditions. One of the traditions that is very old, almost that old, is Judaism. That is the root of where we come from as Christians. And Christianity itself is kind of a newcomer on the scene because it's only been around since the time of Christ. Jesus Christ, born 2,000 years ago, 2,016 years ago, more or less. We don't really know about that. I really appreciate the lead-in that Alice gave me. One of the best things a preacher can have is somebody who will do a good children's time. That is a great gift. I appreciate that. But indeed, since the time of Jesus, there have been Christians, and for a while, there was one church. Many places, they met in houses, they met in different cities, but it was essentially one church. But of course, that didn't last long. After a while, it split between East and West in the early centuries. It's been splitting ever since, but it did remain fairly constant for a while, up until the time of the Reformation. We all know about the Reformation, right? Martin Luther and some others were protesting against some of the things that were happening in the Catholic Church of their time and thinking that reform needed to happen. That's kind of a common theme in churches. Reform needs to happen. So, several churches at that point split off. What a lot of people, including a lot of Methodists, don't know is that we, the Methodists, the Protestant Christians called Methodists, did not come out of the Protestant Reformation. After the time of Luther and Zwingli, there were no Methodists. Until Henry VIII had an issue of marriage. That's another thing that we can't seem to quite get over. And because he couldn't have his way, he created the Church of England. So that was quite a bit later. And that went along for a while, and of course there was a lot of back and forth between Anglican and Catholic, because depending on which side you were, your legitimacy as the ruling monarch was questioned. So of course that's a serious spiritual matter. I'm glad you heard the irony there. Okay. So after a while, there was, again, need for reform. And that was when John Wesley came on the scene. And John Wesley is the, well, we don't really have prophets in Methodism, but if we did, John Wesley would be the prophet of Methodism. And he remained a priest in the Church of England all of his life. It was never his intention to create a new church, to split off and have a different denomination. It was always his intention to reform the church and bring it back together and help it to be what it should have been. But there was this disagreement between the colonies and England, and after the Revolutionary War, there was no way that the Church of England was going to have any influence in this country, and so the Methodist Church was born. That's not that long ago. That's only a few centuries ago. But John Wesley is our guy, and he did not get everything right, of course. The Methodist Church still doesn't get everything right. My congregation still doesn't get everything right. But John Wesley was a pretty good guy. He knew what it meant to live as a child of the divine in the real world. And there was a lot of non-divine in his real world, in his century. He preached generosity, and he practiced what he preached. He was heard to say that if there were more than a few pounds in his pocket when he died, he would be guilty of robbing God, because it was his intention to use all the money that came his way beyond what was absolutely necessary for sustenance to help others. And he visited in the prisons, and he helped the poor, and he built schools, and he wrote books of medicine, some of which is a little bit weird, and some of which is actually kind of commonsensical. He was not afraid to speak truth to power, and he sometimes suffered for that. And he aimed for perfection. And when he said that he was going on to perfection, he did not mean that he was going to be fault-free and always right about everything. What he meant was perfect in love. Perfect in love. Always acting out of love. So here we are now, and John Wesley was a long time ago. Sometimes I wonder what John Wesley would say about some of our issues that we face now. We don't know, because of course his situation was entirely different. I think some Methodists might be surprised about what he would say, but we don't know that. But we do have lots of congregations, we have conferences, we have bishops, and we have lots of differences of opinion, and you probably know that because we make it into the news on a pretty regular basis, especially this year. We have a general conference coming up. We have almost as many personalities of Methodists as we have Methodist congregations. I was in West Texas for 5 years before I came back to Santa Fe. And I can tell you that my Methodist congregation in West Texas, which is really kind of a Baptist congregation in disguise, is about as different as you can possibly imagine from Zia here in Santa Fe. And I am so happy to be at Zia in Santa Fe. I'm glad I had the experience of being at the other church, but I'm really happy to be at Zia in Santa Fe. The Methodists, one of their advertising slogans is open hearts, open minds, open doors. Sometimes we get that right, and sometimes we find ourselves slamming doors in people's faces. But that's very much in the spirit of Wesley. Open hearts, open minds, open doors. And that's what I have found at Zia. I've been here for 2.5 years. I came into this congregation, and I found that everybody was doing something. I think you have a similar kind of feel here, similar environment. People are going to the prisons. People are going to the homeless shelters. People are giving generous donations. People are working hard. People are going out on mission. People are involved in the world around them, and I love that. One of the things about Methodism is that it is a connectional system. It's connectional in that we're connected to other Methodist churches. It's also connectional in that ideally we are connected to other faith communities. I love being part of the ILA and getting to do things like this. And that's very much what our congregation is like. Now, there is St. John's up the street here, and we are similar in a lot of ways to St. John's. We're smaller, but we're also different. We do things together. We do a children's program together where we alternate between our churches because we recognize that we can't do it all, either church, either the big one or the small one. So I enjoy that, but we do have a different personality. They're much more traditional and formal at St. John's. And at Zia, I have one person who says, I love being part of this congregation because we laugh so much. Sometimes we're laughing at ourselves. Frequently we're laughing at ourselves. We do laugh. We take things lightly, and I'm really delighted to be part of that congregation. Another thing that we do, which is similar to you all here, we are sharing our space with another group that worships on Saturdays. It's a Spanish-speaking Seventh-day Adventist group, and that's been a really nice partnership too, the kind of thing that that I really appreciate about my congregation. So I appreciate my congregation, and I appreciate you for letting me share that with you. Thank you.
The anointing at Bethany. Now while Jesus was at Bethany, in the house of Simon the leper, a woman came to him with an alabaster jar of very costly ointment, and she poured it on his head as he sat at the table. But when the disciples saw it, they were angry and said, "Why the waste? For this ointment could have been sold for a large sum and the money given to the poor." But Jesus, aware of this, said to them, "Why do you trouble the woman? She has performed a good service for me. For you always have the poor with you, but you will not always have me. By pouring this ointment on my body, she has prepared me for burial. Truly, I tell you, wherever this good news is proclaimed in the whole world, what she has done will be told in remembrance of her."
One of the interesting things about this story is that it is one of the stories that shows up in one form or another in all four of the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. The four Gospel accounts are very different, and people are constantly trying to make them fit together, and that's hard to do. One of the things that happens with this story is a lot of questions get asked about the differences. It's the kind of thing that biblical interpreters just love to chew over. Okay, who was the woman? Who was the host? How did she anoint him? Yada, 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 yada. It's more helpful to look at the consistencies, to look at the things that are important enough that they made it into all of the accounts. And that is that this woman, whoever she was, had a treasure. She had this ointment in this jar, and it was a very beautiful and costly thing. And she took that, and she gave it, she poured it out in an act of compassion and love. That's wonderful. And the next thing that happens, people complain. They say, "That could have been sold, and the money given to the poor." Well, that's true. Could have. The Gospel of John adds a particular detail that isn't in the other accounts. He says that it was Judas who issued this complaint. And he also says, in a rather snide way, Judas was the treasurer for the disciples, and he had a pretty personal interest in what was in the treasury. So He was wanting to protect the group's resources. The people who were complaining thought that that woman, whoever she was, should have been helping the poor. And the response of Jesus is interesting. He says, "You have the poor with you always." And I have to tell you, I don't like that response. What do you mean, Jesus? Do you mean it doesn't matter whether or not we help the poor? Do you mean that there's always going to be poverty among us? That that's a fact of life? No, I don't like that. I don't like that at all. I began to understand this story in a different way just recently. I've known this story for probably all of my adult life. But in the uproar over welcoming or not welcoming refugees to our country, I've seen the complaint that we should be taking care of our homeless veterans. Should we? Of course we should. We should be taking care of our homeless veterans. Why should we be taking care of them and not taking care of the refugees who have fled threats to home and safety and livelihood and life itself? But you know what? The homeless veterans have been with us all along. We could have been helping them anytime. We don't have to wait. We don't have to wait for the government to say, this is what we're going to do for the refugees, and then complain against it. We don't have to wait to win the lottery. I got curious about the lottery, and so I looked up how many lottery tickets were sold in this last round. Does anybody know? Anybody want to guess? 371 million. A dollar a ticket. What could we do with $371 million? Hmm? Oh, were they $2 a ticket? Oh, okay, excuse me. I could buy a pair of socks for $2 and I could give it to a homeless vet. And then I would have something to show for my $2. If I buy a lottery ticket, which I am not going to do, I don't have anything to show for it because you know what? I'm not going to win the lottery. Even if I did buy a ticket. That money could have gone a long way towards helping the homeless veterans, helping other homeless people, helping the refugees, feeding the hungry, housing the homeless. Most of us, I'm going to guess, have experienced running out of money before we run out a month. It happens. And so we have to make that choice. We have to do what we call robbing Peter to pay Paul. Okay, I have to pay the utility bills because I don't want my lights to get cut off, and I know it's going to cost me more in credit card fees, but that's what I have to do. And then I'll get caught up because I am blessed with abundance, and I will get caught up in another month or so. But we have so many people in our community who are living that all the time. We have mothers who are saying, do I pay the rent or do I buy the medicine that my child needs? We have fathers who are saying, do I go get the groceries or do I put gas in the car so I can go to my job, my part-time, low-wage, no-benefits job? They are always on the edge. And yet others have abundance to share, if only we would. Alice told us about the parables of Jesus. Jesus told parables as teaching tools. And the purpose of a parable is to let us see something in a new way. It's also for us to find ourselves somewhere in the story. Now, this is not a story Jesus told. This is a story about Jesus. It's a parable, too. Where do I find myself in this story? I have to confess, All too often, I'm with the grumblers. I'd prefer to be like the woman. Mark says something that doesn't appear in the other accounts. He says that Jesus replies, "This woman has done what she could. She had the treasure. And in an act of love and compassion, she shared that. She did what she could, using her own resources, not using anybody else's resources, not waiting to win the lottery. I'd like to be like that. And since I seek to live as a disciple of Jesus Christ, I'd like to be like him too." Look how he responds in this situation. He graciously accepts the gift, and that is an art. Graciously accepting a gift is an important skill. And he affirms the giver, and he defends her against her detractors, because she has done something beautiful. So he affirms that. I'd like to be like that. When Jesus says that the poor are always with us, he does not mean that poverty will always be a fact of life. His overall message is one of hope and joy and peace, love and forgiveness. And he promises that there will be a new heaven and a new earth where there is no weeping. As long as people are robbing Peter to pay Paul and falling off the edge, there's weeping. There's weeping and wailing and gnashing of teeth. So it's not going to be with us forever, because that's the promise that we have. Jesus is pointing out that the poor are always with us because we have allowed that situation to continue. And in some cases, we have encouraged that situation. But the choice is ours. We can choose to live as citizens of the new world anytime. Anytime. The opportunity to do good with the resources at my disposal is always available to me. I can give to the poor. I can welcome the refugees. I can help the homeless vets and other homeless anytime. May it be so.
We extinguish the chalice here that it might glow gently in our hearts. May it light your path as you leave this place. May it guide your way until we're together again. For the hand-holding benediction, if you all could join hands. May love and skill be in our hands.
May love and
skill be in our hands.
May love and courage fill our hearts.
May love and courage fill our hearts.
May love and wisdom light our minds.
May love and wisdom light our minds.
May love flow through us and walk among us as we live our lives and help to heal our world.
May love flow through us and walk among us as we live our lives and help to heal our world.
Amen. Shalom. Namaste. And thank you all.